Good morning, everyone. So welcome to yet another online tutorial on principles of communication system. Right. So our previous session, it was a recorded session wherein I've included the simulation of switching modulator, envelope detector, and even we tried to write a MATLAB code to visualize the spectrum of single tone AM. I hope you all of you have gone through that. Right. And so in today's session, initially what we'll do is we'll just see some of the design aspects of envelope detector. Of course, you have seen what envelope detector is and how it works, and even simulation you have seen, but we didn't discuss in detail some of the design aspects. So we'll start with some of the design aspects of envelope detector. Then we'll move on to some of the virtues and limitations of like standard AM system, which we have seen. And in fact, the limitations of different types of AM modulations, we started discussing the topic AM itself with that, right? So again, we'll just revisit what actually is the issue with standard AM and single tone AM, and how can we overcome that? So maybe why do we need to go for DSBSC or SSB or VSB modulation techniques? Right, and we'll after DSBAC we'll see what is a ring modulator, and I'll just with the help of again multi-sim simulation, I'll explain the ring modulator and coherent detector. That is the plan, right? So we'll try to cover that much topic in today's session, right? So with that note, right, we'll just start with today's session. Yeah. So before that, like maybe I would like to call upon someone just to tell me what was there in the previous video. So I will call Sanjay Shankar. Is there Sanjay Shankar Bhatt?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you please, okay. Can you please like tell me what was an envelope detector? In fact, did you see that video which was posted?
Yes, sir. I watched.
Okay. Then what was an envelope detector? Of course, actually that video had some limitation. In fact, I like didn't enable the laser pointer. So even though I was telling this is a diode and all, like the pointer was not there. But I hope it was okay, right? So can you explain what was a like envelope detector? What were the components present in an envelope detector?
The diode.
Right, of course there was a diode. Maybe when you say I'll do, right, so envelope detector, it had a diode, right? See, diode was there, then followed by
diode.
That then
followed by that a capacitor,
like
a resistor,
an RC filter, right? A capacitor and a resistor in,
yes,
parallel, right? So
parallel.
So yeah, this is envelope detector. Maybe I'll call it D, C, and R, right? So and like the input to that was the modulated AM modulated signal, right? So input was AM modulated signal, right? So I'll draw it as a block, right? So AM modulated signal, right? That was the input, right? And if you give an AM modulated signal, so maybe I'll draw it something like this, right? Right, an amplitude modulated signal, if we give to an envelope detector, we'll get the envelope, right, alone. So can you please explain how it worked?
In the positive half cycle, the capacitor charges. Sir.
Yeah, of course. In the positive half cycle, the capacitor charges. Charges to maximum, right? Capacitor charges to maximum, right?
Yes, yes.
But then, when the voltage starts to fall down, what happens? The capacitor, right? It will start discharging, right? So maybe in the positive half cycle, the capacitor will charge to maximum, right? And then, when the voltage starts to fall down, the capacitor will slowly discharge, right? it will charge discharge like this, right? So we have in detail we have seen the waveforms and all those things, right? So that's how it's something similar to what you have learned in first year, like maybe in rectifier circuits, right? Rectifier circuit with a filter, it's exactly the same, right? So this is the simplest and most robust form of actually what demodulator for AM. So some of the other versions of this envelope detector only will be used in, right, most AM transmitters, right? So okay, fine, thank you. Yeah, so now what are the design constraints? That is my question, right? Even though we have seen the multi-sim live simulation and I've explained the working, I've just mentioned while designing an envelope detector, what are the things which you have to keep in mind, right? What are the constraints, right? So now we'll just discuss that, right? So for that, I'll assume, right, the input to this is an AM modulated signal, and maybe we'll assume this as some source, right? This right, AM modulated signal, what I'll do is I'll assume it has some source, waveform source, right, with some internal resistance RS, right? So this whatever I have drawn in this block, right, you can assume it to be a signal source which generates an AM waveform and it has an internal resistance RS, right? So now my question is, right, what is the path through which the capacitor will charge, right? It's obvious when the diode is forward biased, the capacitor will charge through this, right? This is the path through which the capacitor will charge, right? So what are the what is the charging time constant of capacitor? Maybe we'll note it down, right? Charging time constant, I'll write it as tau, right? What is the charging time constant of capacitor? Of course, it will include the internal resistance of the AM modulator, right? And if you are assuming this diode to be an ideal diode, right? And if we can be in forward resistance of the diode, if I can write as RF, right? So I'm assuming the diode to be an ideal diode. In forward bias, the diode will have a resistance equal to forward resistance equal to RF, and in reverse bias, it will be open, right? So the forward resistance of diode, that is RF, right, times C. This will be charging time constant, right? This will be charging time constant of the circuit, right? So why? Because it will charge through the diode, right? Internal resistance of this signal, diode and the capacitor. And what will be the path through which the capacitor will discharge? Can anyone tell? When the diode is reverse biased, this will be open, right? When the diode is reverse biased, right, this will be open, this part will be open. So what is the path through which the diode will discharge? This is the path through which diode will discharge, right? So what is the discharging time constant? Can anyone tell me? What is the discharging time constant? Yeah, can anyone unmute and tell? Or else you may even type it in chat window. Right. What is the discharging time constant? Pratik and Sherwin has written resistor. Okay, yeah. Maybe that is the path. What is the discharging time constant? That is equal to R into C, right? That is nothing but equal to R into C. Now, what should be the charging and discharging time constant? Right. What should be the charging and discharging time constants? Right. So the condition, right, or the design constraint is, if FC is carrier frequency, if FC is carrier frequency, right, what will be carrier time period? Carrier time period will be 1 by FC, right? Carrier time period will be 1 by FC, right? So the charging should happen at the rate or even faster compared to this 1 by FC, right? The charging should happen faster compared to 1 by FC, right? And the discharging should happen slower, right? The discharging should happen slower, right? So this is what you have to keep in mind while designing an envelope detector, right? So I'll just write this or RF plus RS into C. That is nothing but what charging time constant, right? It should be much less compared to 1 by FC, right? It is much less compared to 1 by FC. You might have studied this in first year already, right? And the discharging time constant, right? The discharging time constant, it should follow the condition. This 1 by FC, right, should be much, much less compared to RC. And this RC in turn should be less compared to actually what? 1 by W. What is W actually? W can be the maximum frequency content of the message or bandwidth of the message, right? So what it says is this RC should not be actually what comparable with message time period. If RC is comparable with message time period, what will happen is discharging RC is comparable with message time period, what will happen is the capacitor will charge and then it won't discharge. It will discharge very slowly. Then we won't be able to what get back the envelope. But what should happen is here I'll show, right, the capacitor should charge, right? It should charge, discharge, charge, discharge within, right? It should be like this. So these are the design conditions. So I just wanted to mention these two as well. So remaining thing in detail we have discussed in the previous video, right? So this is the design aspects of envelope detector, right? So this is the design aspect of envelope detector, right? So at this point I would like to pause and ask if you have any doubt, right? Any doubt? So envelope detector, you should be able to what with a circuit diagram explain the working of an envelope detector, and maybe at times there can be some like numericals which is related to the design aspects, right? So that also you should be able to tell, right? So and one more thing, right, I would like to stress here is, right, one more thing I would like to stress here, maybe you can call it as limitation or envelope detector, or right, envelope detector is designed for, right, this AM, for this envelope detector to work properly, right, for this envelope detector to work properly, the AM modulated signal, this also you should keep in mind, the AM modulated signal should be narrow band. The AM modulated signal should be narrow band, and the modulation index should be less than 1, or modulation factor should be less than or equal to 100%, right? So modulation index should be less than or equal to 1, or modulation factor should be less than or equal to 100%, right? So why do we say this modulation factor should be less than or equal to 100%? Can anyone tell? This is as the name suggests, it detects the envelope, right? So envelope, in the sense, as there is a diode, what happens is it allows only actually what initially itself, it clips off the negative part, the negative envelope it clips off, right? So what we'll get is only the positive part, right? And that positive part we are reconstructing using a filter. That is what is an envelope detector, right? So modulation index is greater than 1, what happens is we will not get a well-defined envelope. There will be phase reversal, right? We have already seen that. So phase reversal, what it does is it distorts the envelope, right? So because of that, when mu is greater than 1, as there is phase reversal, if you use an envelope detector, the envelope which we retrieve will not be the exact envelope which we need, right? So that is one thing. That is why this mu should be less than 1, right? And what do you mean by narrow band? Narrow band simply means, right, this carrier frequency should be much greater compared to the message bandwidth. So the spectrum should be something like this, right? FC plus W and FC minus W, right? So this bandwidth should be much less compared to FC. So that is another condition for this envelope detector to work. So I will just quickly wrap up. For this envelope detector to work properly, the message AM modulated signal should be narrow band, and modulation index should be less than or equal to 1, or modulation factor is less than 100%, right? and the design constraints, the charging time constant should be much less compared to the carrier time period, and the discharging time constant should be greater than the carrier time period. At the same time, it should be much less compared to the message time period. Right. So maybe the first condition, the signal, the need for signal to be narrow band, it is related to, say, this design constraint, in fact. Right. So that's all about envelope detector. Right. So now we'll move on to DSB-SC. So before that, we have to see what are the what are some of the pros and cons of the standard AM. So give me a moment. Right. So I hope you remember the slide. This was one of the first slides which we discussed when we started the topic, amplitude modulation. I'll just maximize it. Right. This was one of the first slides which we discussed when we were discussing the AM modulation. Right. So before that, anyone has any doubt in this envelope detector part? Please respond yes or no. Right. If you have doubt, you can say yes. No, you can just type it in no. Right. So that I can proceed. We have discussed this thing, right? So the need for you to respond, we have already discussed. So please do respond. Am I audible to everyone, first of all? Is it because you are not responding because I'm not audible? Right. If I was not audible by this time, I would have received some messages in this, right? So am I audible? Can you respond to that at least? Yes. Right. So, and any doubt in this envelope detector part? Please feel free to ask. If you have any doubt, please feel free to ask. Right. So I did not go back and explain the basic working of an envelope detector because I have posted a video already. Right. And I was expecting you people to watch that. So please, whichever videos are posted, right, please do watch that before you come for a live session. Right. So effort from your side should be there. Right. So if anyone is feeling, finding it difficult, so you can just revisit that video, that simulation of envelope detector, and also, right, I'll make this recorded session available that also you can watch. Right. So for the time being, I didn't get any response yet. Any doubt in envelope detector? No, right. So maybe if you have any doubt, right, most probably it can be because you are not familiar with, or you might have forgotten the aspects of the time constant, right? So RC circuits, right? Charging and discharging, right? So maybe you can just revisit those aspects. I don't think I have to discuss it here in detail. Maybe if you want, you can just tell me. I can provide you materials to brush up those aspects, or if even I can include a small I can post a small recorded session also. Right. So okay, so now we'll move forward with this with the session. So next we have to see, we have learned standard AM, right, generation, detection. We have even derived the spectrum. We have seen single tone modulation, right? We have seen switching modulator, envelope detector, right? So now we'll discuss what are the virtues and limitations, or pros and cons of this standard AM. So before that, I would like you to recollect this particular slide. This was one of the first slides which I had included in the first recorded session of AM. So wherein we were just trying to have a big picture of what are the different types of AM, what is the motivation behind actually what having these different types, right? So just now we finished standard AM, wherein the spectrum, if I right, spectrum, it looks like this, right? So it has you can see by seeing the spectrum itself, it has a carrier within itself, right? But the carrier as such, it doesn't have any, doesn't contain any like information, right? So there is upper sideband and lower sideband, right? And this upper sideband and lower sideband, as you can see, the signals which we are considering are real valued, right? And the spectrum of the signal is symmetric about f is equal to zero, right? The upper sideband and lower sideband, they will also be symmetric about carrier frequency fc, right? So the information which is contained within upper sideband and lower sideband, both are same. So if you know the magnitude and phase spectra of upper sideband, you can always easily reconstruct or retract what is the information within therein lower sideband, right? So this, if this carrier as such, I told, it does not contain any information, right? And the upper sideband and lower sideband, both are having same information. So in fact, ideally, right, only a bandwidth of W would have been more than W would have been sufficient to what carry the information, right? But for ease of implementation, what we have done is, so you have seen a switching modulator, how simple it is, right? It has got only a diode and a resistor, right? Of course, with MFT and CFT fed in series, right? So the generation of standard AM is as simple as that. That simplicity is actually what is at the expense of this power, right? The extra power which we are transmitting, and also the additional bandwidth. So first I'll write the pros or virtues of standard AM, right? It's very simple, right? It's very simple, right? Modulation and demodulation are very simple. We have seen we can generate a modulated signal using a switching modulator, right? Or a switching modulator or a square law modulator. Square law modulator later on during while we are discussing a problem, I'll discuss, right? So and the demodulation is also very simple. That is one of the greatest advantages, right? So then what are the cons of standard AM, right? I'm discussing about standard AM. What are the cons of standard AM? One is actually what power wastage, right? I told, right, the most important resources as far as any communication system is concerned is power and bandwidth, right? So, and we have even discussed what may be the reasons for these being the important resources, right? So power and bandwidth are important resources, right? So here we are wasting power in carrier, as we have seen, even when the modulation index was equal to, right, even when the modulation index was equal to 1, what was the total power within carrier, percentage of total power within carrier? Can anyone tell me this? When modulation index was equal to 1, that is actually what the number of modulation index which gives maximum power efficiency, right? When mu is equal to 1, we will have maximum power in sidebands, right? So then we can tell AM is the most efficient. But even at that time, can anyone tell me what is the power within the carrier? Can anyone tell? Even for mu equal to 1? So not a problem. I can call someone's name and ask, right? Yeah, someone is typing in 33. So Prajwal has typed it's 33%, but in 33% is in sidebands, right? So only 1/3 is in sideband. So when mu is equal to 1, only 1/3 of the total power is the useful power, right? Remaining 2/3 was in carrier, right? So what Prajwal told is correct, but it's actually what a complement of that. 2/3 is in carrier, 2/3 is wasted. Even when we say for mu equal to 1, we have the most efficiency, right? We have the most efficiency the power wastage is almost around 67%, right? So that is one important thing. And second one is again actually what bandwidth wastage. As I have told just now, right, this upper sideband and lower sideband, they are symmetric about FC, right? Knowing the magnitude and phase of one sideband, it can give you the information about the other sideband, right? So ideally, right, so here the bandwidth is 2W, right? So you can see in standard FM, the bandwidth is 2W, but ideally W would have been sufficient, right? So the bandwidth wastage, if we say, if you compare with ideal, right, it uses 100% more bandwidth, right? It uses 100% more bandwidth, right? So the bandwidth requirement is also high in AM. So these are the virtues and limitations of standard AM, right? So we can, and one more limitation is there, as amplitude modulation carries information within the amplitude, right, variation of the carrier, right? Normally, if we have some nonlinear noise, so you don't have to bother about noise, we'll study in the third unit in detail, right? So whenever we have an additive noise or a nonlinear noise, what happens is it easily affects the amplitude, right? Only when there is some nonlinearity, it will affect phase or frequency, right? But amplitude is very easily affected even with a additive noise. So that is also actually what one of the drawbacks, right? So, but for that, we'll have to go for other like types of modulation, FM or something, right? But now within AM, right, within different variants of AM, if you discuss the limitations of standard AM, these are the limitations of standard AM. And of course, the simplicity is a pro, but it is at a cost of actually what excess power and bandwidth which we spend, right? So now for that, what we told is actually maybe we can suppress the carrier part, right? We can suppress the carrier part. Right. So before that, can anyone tell me what was S of T time domain expression for a standard AM? Please. Can anyone tell me what was time domain expression for standard AM? What happened? Why all are silent? I'm not getting response. Right, at least you could have used a chat window, right? Maybe I think, right. Shiva Prasad. Yes, Shiva Prasad. So, okay, Shervin has typed it in. So, can I have a Shiva Prasad unmuted? Shivya?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Shivya, please tell me what is the time domain expression of standard AM?
AC into 1 plus KAM of
AC into 1 plus KAM of
T into cos omega.
Cos 2 pi FCT. Yes, right. So you can see it has a AC cos 2 pi FCT plus AC into KAM of T cos 2 pi FCT, right? So there is a carrier term separate. So in the next type of AM modulation which we are going to study, what we'll do is we'll have a spectrum like this. You can see there is no delta function, right, with a weight of AC by 2 at FC and minus FC. So carrier is suppressed. That's why we are calling it carrier suppressed, right, double sideband carrier suppressed modulation scheme. And the time domain expression of this is again straightforward. Right, it's just right. S of T, if I can write, it will be AC cos 2 pi FCT times M of t, right? So we don't have a carrier term separate, right? So it's just we are multiplying the carrier term with a message term, right? So can anyone tell me what will be the spectrum of this? If M of f a spectrum of the message signal, right? If M of f a spectrum of message signal, and we can see spectrum of SFF, it's shown here. How can I write it mathematically? How can I express it mathematically? Spectrum SFF. Can anyone tell me what will be this? Yeah. Please. What will be SFF here? Okay, yeah, Shiv Prasad has messaged. Actually, he has some network issue. His voice is breaking. Right. So fine. For I hope for others, my voice is audible. Is it proper now? Yeah. So Sherwin has typed. It's Fourier transform of f of t. Yes, of course. What is Fourier transform of f of t now? Right. What is Fourier transform of f of t? Right. I'll write it here. It will be half times AC into M of f minus FC plus M of f plus FC. So we have discussed these aspects in detail, right? So starting from the Euler's or Euler's equation, right? And the frequency shifting property of Fourier transform, right? We found what is the Fourier transform of cosinusoid or sinusoid, right? And then what will happen when you multiply a real valued baseband signal with a cosinusoid of a frequency FC? What will happen to its spectrum? We have discussed those things in detail, right? So this S of f will be half AC times M of f minus FC plus M of f plus FC. That is what is shown here. So here what happens is we can save the power which is wasted on carrier, right? Because the carrier is suppressed. We don't have a carrier term separate, right? So if you remember in the time domain expression for standard AM, we had a carrier term plus AC KA M of t cos 2 pi FCT, but here we don't have an extra carrier term, right? So that is DSB SC. So there we can save the power which is wasted in carrier. But what we, the bandwidth, you can see the bandwidth is retained the same as standard AM. It is equal to 2W, right? So here again we have upper side band and lower side band, right? So that is M of right. We have above FC and below FC, we have frequency contents, right? So upper sideband and lower sideband we are transmitting. So that is another like a drawback. So even though it can save power, right, the bandwidth is 2W, right? So that is another problem with our double sideband suppressed carrier modulation. So basically double sideband suppressed carrier modulation, here carrier is suppressed, right? So the time domain expression becomes S of t is equal to AC cos 2 pi FCT into M of t, right? So the the spectrum we can easily be obtained by taking Fourier transform of this S of t. That is S of f is equal to half AC M of f minus FC plus M of f plus FC, right? So now next what we'll do is we'll try and see one of the easiest methods to practically generate this DSBSC signal, right? So we'll see that. Before that, what we can do is now the power is power in carrier waste, power wasted in carrier is reduced in DSBSC, but like the we can further reduce the bandwidth. So to further reduce the bandwidth requirement, we can either go for vestigial sideband modulation, right? Here what happens is the one complete US upper sideband and a part of lower sideband, or complete lower sideband and a part of upper sideband. It's either right, it is transmitted. So what happens is the bandwidth is less than 2W, right? The bandwidth is less than 2W, right? And this vestigial sideband, normally it is used for wideband signals such as video, right? Video signals where we do have significant frequency contents around DC, right? So we can use this vestigial sideband modulation for video transmission. And in practice, right, in video transmission in practice, what will happen is for ease of synchronization and detection, a carrier also will be transmitted. But vestigial sideband means there won't be any carrier, and a complete upper sideband or complete lower sideband and a part of the other sideband. That is what we'll use for vestigial sideband modulation. And in single sideband modulation, it is most apt for voice signals. We have seen it already, right? So the you can see the spectrum of voice signal. It doesn't have significant frequency content from say 0 to some say 1 kilohertz, right? There is no significant frequency content, right? So around DC there is a null, right? So what happens is the modulated, like we can easily suppress, we can easily actually what separate either upper sideband or lower sideband, right, without any loss of information, right? So that's what is SSB. So we'll see, first we'll see this DSBAC. So DSBAC, the mathematical modeling part, it's only this much, right? S of T is directly C of T into M of T, right? And the spectrum is this. It can be easily obtained by what taking Fourier transform of this. So I'm not discussing it now. We'll move on to see what is actually a ring modulator. So ring modulator I'll explain with the help of a multi-sim live simulation, right? Yeah, so till here, right, in any queries. So I'll just stop sharing this and I'll see. Yeah, so please, if any doubt is there on, am I going too fast? Like, do you think I am skipping some of the basics which you require to know? Yeah, please. So now, from now on, what we'll do is we'll try to what, as we have spent considerably more time by discussing some of the basics, right? Now maybe I want you people to be prepared so that I can slightly increase the pace, right? And most of all, what I do believe is it's like my duty is not to what tell you what to learn or right to help you out remember things, but I would consider if I can tell you how to learn, right, what like this particular topic, if you know this and this, you can actually what learn it better, right? So that's what I believe, and that's what I will try to what focus on as well, right? So the effort from your side that you have to put, but if you have any doubt, right, please feel free to ask. And if you want some sort of actually what for some derivations and problems, if you want me to give a sort of say written notes, do you want me to do that? Please someone post it in chat window. Right, so these discussion plus right, so okay, now all are all started responding, right? So okay, yeah, so that I can give. So whatever I am discussing here, maybe the PPT as such or the materials I can share, right? It's not a problem, but right, if I discuss something, if I post a video, right, I am expecting you to what go through that video and come prepared for the next live session. Right, that's why, that is the very reason why I am assigning the videos through Edpuzzle, which is integrated to Canvas, right? So I can track the progress. I can see how like how many people have seen that video. So if, maybe if you want, I can just show that. Right, I'll just show this. We'll just see the statistics of previous video which is posted in Edpuzzle, right? And then maybe I'll just see whether I can relate it to the silence, right? When I ask questions, right? So maybe I'll just share our right. So principles of communication system. Right. So these are the videos I've posted. So maybe I'll just try and see. Right.
Dear students, welcome to yet another online tutorial.
Right. So maybe we'll see how many I've watched the previously assigned videos. Yeah, this video I added like yeah, so this video I had posted it in Edpuzzle, right? So I'll get to know who all have watched, right? So you can see it's mostly blank, right? Some of you have watched it halfway through, right? So I can track it, right? So that's the very reason why I am posting it through Edpuzzle, right? So if someone is finding some topic difficult, right, I should trace back what may be the reason, right? So for that like information will definitely help me, right? So please what you should do is, if any video is posted, right, please go through that and come prepared, right? I'm expecting you to know whatever prerequisites I've discussed till the previous session, so that we can continue smoothly with the sessions, right? So yeah, now we'll again move on to our discussion on ring modulator, right? So I'll just present the multisim simulation of ring modulator. Right, is it visible now? All of you can see this?
No, sir.
You can't see, like I've just shared that multisim live tab to everyone, right? One second. So now, can anyone check? Is it visible? Whatever multisim live tab I have shared.
Yes, sir.
Internet vendor. Oh, now it's. Now, yeah, now it came, right? Okay, so I think I had some internet issue, right? That's why. So now I think now it is visible. Right. Yeah, it's visible now, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Yeah, so this is a like a practical means to generate a DSBAC, double sideband suppressed carrier signal, right? So maybe the design aspects, I'll do it as an offline video, right? What I'll do now is I'll just demonstrate it, right? How it works, and maybe the circuit construction I'll demonstrate now. So here we have a message signal. Message signal is given, all of you can see my cursor, I hope, right? Is given to the input of primary of the transformer one, right? And it's a center tap transformer. Message signal is given at the primary of transformer one, and the carrier signal C of T, right? In fact, this carrier signal, normally in your textbook, when they have discussed, they have shown it as a square wave, right? So as I have I'm using multisim live and I don't have square wave as such, I have used a sinusoid to represent it. Of course, I can actually use a clock pulse and clamp it down to get a square wave. Maybe I'll ask you to try out that, but right, to explain the circuit, I think this one would be more than sufficient, right? So I have this carrier signal C of T, right, which is fed, you can see it is fed longitudinally, right? So there are two transformers, T1 and T2, as you can see, and and these are center tap transformers, and to these between these center taps, actually what the carrier signal C of T is fed. So I have M of T, which is given to primary of T1, and C of T, which is fed longitudinally between actually what the secondary, the center tap of secondary of T1 and center tap of primary of T2, the transistors, right? And I have a ring of diodes. Why do we call it a ring? You can see all these diodes are actually what facing the same direction, and it forms a ring, right? So because of that, the circuit has got a name, ring modulator, right? And if you remember, we had studied switching modulator, right? That was used to generate standard AM, right? So that switching modulator, we used only one diode, and because of that itself, it was clipping off the negative part. It was getting off during the negative half cycle of the carrier, right? So it is, and I have told, it is equivalent to what, multiplying it with a clock pulse, right? Or a clock pulse with only positive amplitude, right? So if you consider clock pulse, right, and if you take average of this, average of a clock pulse, as it has got only positive amplitude, the average or DC value of a clock pulse, it will always be greater than zero. It will be there will be a finite DC value, right? So when you are multiplying a signal, cosinusoid, with some other signal which has a finite DC value, so it's like, if you remember the Fourier series expansion of that clock pulse, right? Anyone remember the Fourier series expansion of that clock pulse? Square pulse with only a positive amplitude. How did we expand it using Fourier series expression? I had given it as a homework, right, for you to expand it and write down the final expression for the standard AM. Can anyone tell me what is that? What was that? Yeah, it was half plus, right, 2 by pi. So maybe I'll take up, I'll just take a pen and maybe I'll write it down, right? So 1 second. So here, it's half plus 2 by pi times summation, right, minus 1 to the power n divided by 2n minus 1, right, cos of 2 pi F times 2n minus 1 times T, right? So that was the, so if you see that, it has an A0 value, half is there, right? So because of that, what will happen is the modulated signal will have a carrier term plus carrier times message, right? But here, right, we are using this ring of diode, so it will allow both positive and negative actually what amplitudes, right? So, or half cycles. So that DC part of the modeling is actually what removed. So I'll explain those things in detail in an offline video. So now, to know the working, so what you can see here is during positive half cycle of the carrier, right? During positive half cycle of the carrier, what will happen is, right, two of the diodes will be, right, during positive half cycle of the carrier, two of these diodes will be forward bias and other two will be reverse biased. And during negative half cycle, the other two, which were actually reverse biased, will be forward biased, and the one which was forward biased earlier will be reverse biased, right? So that we will get a continuous output here, right? And the output what we'll be getting here will be, right, a square wave times the message signal. So maybe instead of square wave, I have already used a sinusoid here, but it won't be a problem. We'll just simulate and see what is the output, right? So one more problem is, as we are multiplying C of t with M of t directly, right, and amplitude of C of t will vary with respect to M of t, and M of t in turn will be having actually what, positive and negative amplitudes, right? So whenever M of t's amplitude is positive, it's not a problem. It will actually what, amplify the amplitude of C of t. But whenever M of t is going negative, what will happen? There will be a phase reversal, right? There will be a phase reversal. That's what you can see here, right? That's what you can see here, right? So it's like, right, you can see the envelope, right? So you can see the phase reversal here. So this is a message signal. So maybe I'll show the message signal here, right? I'll show the message signal. Like, this is our message signal. I'll use another probe to display the message signal. Right. So now I'll simulate once again. Right. So you can see the envelope. Oh. Right. Right, it's actually what, because of the phase reversal, right? So during, right, we are getting an envelope like this. It's equal to what, a standard AM with mu greater than one, right? So this phase reversal is there, and of course with carrier part suppressed, right? So there is a phase reversal. Whenever this message is positive, right, it's fine. But whenever I'll zoom and show, right, whenever you can see the message turns negative from positive, actually what, phase of the carrier is reversed, right? Phase of the carrier is reversed. So this is actually what, double sideband suppressed carrier. If carrier part was there, it would have been, you remember how the waveform looked like. Now the carrier part is suppressed, so the phase reversal, it is inevitable, it will be there, it is inherent, right? So for that, what we should have is to demodulate this, right? We should add, right, the demodulator, right, will have more complications actually what built into it, right? So because of this phase reversal, we cannot anyhow use an envelope detector, right? If I use an envelope detector, what, it will be like a rectifier, a full wave rectifier output, what you will get. You won't get the envelope back, right? If you use an envelope detector here, right, you will get something like this, right? This part, right? This part. So negative half cycles, actually the envelope in right, the information is partly in positive envelope and in negative envelope, right? But whereas in standard AM, the information was completely there in positive envelope, and same thing, but with a phase reversal was there in negative envelope. But here the information, it is partly there in positive envelope, right, and partly there in negative envelope. So I can't use an envelope detector here, right? So I should complicate my a demodulator or detector to demodulate this. But of course the advantage is actually what, the carrier part is suppressed, the power wastage is reduced, right? But the disadvantage is increased complexity of the transmitter and receiver, right? So if you see the transmitter part itself, there we had only one diode and a resistor, but here we have actually what, two transistors, four diodes, right? I do center tap transistors, right? So it's complicated. So we have power saving at the cost of actually what, complexity of transmitter and receiver. So detailed mathematical modeling and maybe analysis of the waveforms of this ring modulator and the coherent detector and Costa's receiver part. We will discuss on Monday. Monday we have a live session. During that we will discuss, and the next session will be a recorded session. The further parts I'll be posting it as in a recorded session. So for now, right, I want you to see this waveforms and the simulation part and just understand like the detail working. Right, with equivalent circuit diagrams we will show the detailed working of this ring modulator in next live session, of course with mathematical modeling. So by the time we have our next live session, I request everyone to complete watching the videos which are posted so far, right? And if you have any doubt, you can either actually email me or even direct message me, but I'll be very happy to help you out, right? So please, the effort from your side, that also you have to put, right? So, and of course this portions are discussed, right, maybe if it involves some derivations or mathematical modeling part, that material separately I'll make available, right? But I want you to take down lecture notes if possible. So anyhow, right, I'll be making this video also available in Canvas, right? So you can just watch it again later, take down lecture notes, right? So I think that's all about ring modulator. Maybe we'll move wind up today's session here. Right, we'll wind up today's session. Right. So before that, anyone has any doubt or any suggestions to give? Right. Maybe so today what we are discussed is we started with design constraints of envelope detector, right? Then we have seen what are the pros and cons of standard AM modulator and what are the different other options to overcome those faults, right? Then we have seen the time domain expression and one method for generating the DSBAC waveform. Right, so that's what we have seen in today's session. So if you have any